how to stand up as we sing these songs together. Here we go.
Jesus, your love is my aim, you're my only
When we watch God and we look back in the past, we can always see, maybe not always, a lot of times we can look back and see what he was doing. We're like, sometimes in the present, we're just like, what in the world is going on in this moment, God? But you look back and you see that even in the valley, it's easy to see God in the mountains, but in the valley, he's still there with us. And before we go on and sing any more songs, I just want to ask if you would, we have people still coming in some spots we need to make available to them. If you could squeeze towards the middle of your section, leave the spots on the outside so people can easily take those up. That way families can sit together. I'd appreciate that. But when I think about God's faithfulness, here's one thing I do know. God is always faithful. I've seen it over and over played out in my life. Here's what I don't know. How he's going to do it. What timing is going to work out for the way he wants it to work out in my life. And it's hard sometimes for me to see in the present the struggle that I'm going through and at the same time going, God, are you still there? Are you still working in my life? Because it kind of feels like you're not there right now. And to know that he is, because every time I look back, it's like that poem, Footprints, if you've ever heard it before. It's in those times where I thought I was alone, when I was in my deepest need, it was in those times that I look back and I saw that God was carrying me. And he's always there with you. And we don't always know how he's going to work out his plan, but he is working. He's working out a way in your life that you don't even aware that's happening, and he's going to work it out. Sing this song with us.
garments. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you. I worship you. Oh, you believe. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keep. Light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keep. Light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are here, touching every heart. I worship you. I worship you. You are here. You're healing every heart. I worship you. I worship you.
Stop working, even when I don't.
That is who he is. Let's pray, guys. God, this morning as we sing that song, it's a reminder to us of the fact that we don't always see you how you're working in our lives, but we know this, you are working, and you are the one who is the way maker, working out a way in each one of our situations. So God, we celebrate that today. We thank you for it, and we worship you. In your name we pray, amen. All right, turn to a few folks near you that you didn't come with, say hello, welcome to Epic, and then you may take your seat.
All right. Good morning, everybody. Welcome to Epic. My name is Devin. We are so glad you're here with us today. How many of you guys enjoyed the sunshine this week? Now, don't be fooled. Rain is coming. So enjoy it while you can, right? Most of us Oregonians that are born and raised know we still got a second winter coming along. So don't you worry. If this is your first time, we've got a gift for you called How Good Is Good Enough. It's going to be on the back table as you leave the building. And then you should have got a program when you walked in. Inside that program, you're going to have a connection card. That's how we connect with you guys. So make sure you fill that out, update any information, and then you can put it in the black buckets as they go through at the end of the service. We got some events coming up. Who's married in this room? All right. Looks like you guys need the marriage booster. All right. So next week is the marriage booster. If you were not cheering and not excited when I asked who's married, this event is for you. All right. It's $30. Today is the last day to pay and sign up on your connection card. It's from 7 to 9, and childcare will be provided. I know my wife and I are going to go. It's going to have some fun, some food, and just to learn some tools to help your relationship no matter what stage you are, whether you've been married a couple years or 25 years. It's just a good way to learn some tools to help out your marriage. And then next Sunday, who knows what next Sunday is? There we go. Who's rooting for the Chiefs in here? All right, a bigger crowd than I expected. Who's rooting for the Niners in here? All right, Niners have the room. So who's rooting for the food and the snacks in here? Now we know why everybody's going to the Super Bowl party. Next week, we're going to ask everybody, wear your team jersey. I'm going to be wearing my Seahawks jersey. We're going to kick it off with some food, some games, just a good time to get excited for the Super Bowl. And then we are going to possibly have a goodie pack to win to be able to have some more snacks for your Super Bowl parties. So now let's pull out your notes as we kick off our new series, It's Complicated.
Right. I'm excited in particular, Devin was talking about the marriage brewster. It's like, apparently it's a marriage conference with brew. I heard him. Did anybody else hear marriage brewster? Okay. All right. Okay. I was like, oh, all right. That's a new spin on it, but okay. Love it. Thank you, Devin. And by the way, I'm with you on the Chiefs. Anybody out there?
Chiefs.
All right. Very cool. All right, we're going to kick off a brand new series today that I've been excited about for a while. It's the love month. This is February, and we're going to be talking in this month, the entire month, about relationships. And this new series we're kicking off today is called It's Complicated. And I really do believe in a lot of ways in all of our relationships, not just the ones in our home, like with our spouse or our kids, but you know, our coworkers, the people that are our neighbors, all the people that we interact with in our life. Relationships can be complicated. And I think the only reason why they get complicated is truthfully because they step outside of the boundaries of God's plan for them. God has a prescription for our relationships, and when we get out of those boundaries, I think that's when we start to experience the complications of the relationship. You saw the tagline, it's complicated, but it doesn't have to be. And hopefully in this series, we're going to uncomplicate your relationships a little bit for you. Now today, I want to warn you that today we're going to kick off with a doozy. This topic here is on sexuality and morality. And so I just want to prepare you for that. It is going to be maybe slight little PG-13 if you got kids with you. This is a great day to test out the kids' classes and the student classes. Just thought I'd throw that out there. Might get a little bit racy, but we'll keep it on the rails today. But I wanted to kick off not only today's topic, but this series with a quote by C.S. Lewis that I think really encapsulates where we are as a culture. He says this, human history is the long, terrible story of man trying to find something other than God which will make him happy. I think that sums it up right there. We go through this struggle of trying to find something outside of God and his plan for our lives to make us happy. Therein lies the complications. Therein lies what he calls the long, terrible story. And we're going to dive in today to a passage of scripture that's not in your notes, but you see the reference there, Romans chapter 1. And if you have your Bible, if you have your phone and want to get your app out, get it ready to go, queue up Romans chapter 1 so you get that ready here. But we're going to dive. Oh, by the way, if you have ever grabbed, or maybe you don't have a Bible, or you're not familiar with the Bible, and you ever grab a Bible on the back table, you can grab that anytime and bring that in here if you want to have a Bible to go through. But I want to start giving you the page numbers, so if you don't know where to find it, you can find it. This is page 675 in the Bible on the back table. Now, if that's not the one you got, don't look to that 675. It means nothing to you. But I thought I'd just give you a little help with that. This passage here is going to be kind of our theme throughout this entire series. And I've got it open in my Bible, and I'm going to read it out of my notes because I got some notes that I want to go along with this as I'm talking through it. But if you'll pick up in Romans chapter 1, and starting in verse 21, Paul is the author writing to the church in ancient Rome, and he says this, yes, they knew God, speaking of people, but they wouldn't worship him as God. Let me pause there and explain to you. Worship in this is talking about, it's not talking about like a church service with some music, you know, maybe a couple announcements and a message. We're not talking about that, although that can be worship. What we're talking about is giving worth to God. They wouldn't worship God. They wouldn't consider him to be worthy of their worship. And honestly, in our lives, if we don't think that God has the right to say what's wrong and right in our lives, then maybe we're the God in our life that we're worshiping. See, here's the thing. If you do not believe there is a God, you become the God. That's the way it works because you're calling all the shots. You play God in your life if you don't see God and don't see his authority in your life. So hang on to that thought. We're going to move on. They wouldn't worship him as God or even give him thanks. And they began to think up foolish ideas of what God was like. They started coming up with their own ideas of who God was, what God's like, what God is telling us to do or not to do. Have you seen this in culture at all? As a result, their minds became dark and confused. Verse 22, claiming to be wise, they instead became utter fools. C.S. Lewis also has this other quote. He says that culture plays this thing called chronological snobbery. And the idea of chronological snobbery, I'm going to say Brewster for you, Devin. There you go. Chronological snobbery is the idea that any culture before you was less sophisticated, less intelligent, and as culture evolves, we become smarter. And so we know better in our generation than the generation behind us, the generation behind them. It's this idea that we figure it out. And so they became fools, basically, as a result of that. Verse 24, I'm going to skip to 24. So God abandoned them to do whatever shameful things their hearts desired. As a result, they did vile and degrading things with each other's bodies. Verse 25, they traded the truth about God for a lie. This, my friends, is, I believe, why relationships get complicated. Truth be known, this whole series, this entire, like if you want to know what the series is about, it's basically me hopefully in my best effort to share truth with you, to hopefully dispel lies that you've bought into or somehow fallen into these traps, to give you the truth so you can go back on track and say, okay, that was wrong. I got to get back on track here. That is what uncomplicates our relationships. At the end of the day, though, no matter what I say, you make your own choice. I'm not here to coerce you or somehow make you feel guilty. My job is, as best as I can, is to try and share with you what I believe is best as I know what is truth, and for you to do whatever you want with it, because we all have free will. You make your own choice. But here, I'll tell you this, that if at the end of the day you don't buy into this and you think that you know a better way, I promise you this. You're going to find out. Life will teach you. I don't have to convince you. Life will show you the way your choices and what difficulties it'll bring along the way. Here's the thing. I also want you to be aware of that Satan is the one. He's the father of lies, Scripture tells us. And his whole job is to try and feed you a bunch of lies to misguide you in the direction you're going. If he can get you off track, you'll go with a different result than where you would have gone if you had stayed on to the truth. As the father of lies, here's what you need to know about him. Don't fear him. Fear the fact that he's got lies he shares with you that you buy into, because really, in all actuality, he can't do anything to you except for deceive you. He's not going to touch you. He's not going to plague you. He's not going to take your life from you. He can't do any. He has no power. God has not allowed him to have the power to do those things. But what he will do is he will feed you lies, and it's up to you whether or not you're going to buy into the truth or the lie. Here's the thesis of today's message in your notes. If you don't have those out, by the way, get those notes handy. But here's the thesis of the message. In order for relationships to work, let the one who designed them be the one who defines them. We can't define relationships. We can't make up our own definitions. We can't come up with our own version of truth to be able to rely on to lead our lives. Let the one who designed the relationships be the one who defines them. And today might set you a little bit on edge. You know, it's a little bit of a difficult topic, and you might find yourself at some point in time as we're going through this, like, with a little nervous, like, like, should I have laughed there? I don't know. Like, and that's okay. We'll get through this together. But understand this, that as we talk through this, the world is not afraid to talk about this subject. The world is very forward in talking about sexuality and morality. Our culture, our generation, has never been more hypersexualized than it is right now. And so there's a lot out there of what the world says, this is what you're supposed to do, or this is what's acceptable. So I believe in our responsibility as a church that we have to also come up there and teach and show with responsibility what God teaches about this subject. I think the church has been far too quiet on it. We have to be open and vocal about this. When I grew up in church, I never heard sex ever talked about in church growing up. In fact, my family, we didn't talk about it. Now, our family today, in our household, it gets brought up quite often, and we're very open the way we talk about it, because we wanted to make sure that our kids had an opportunity to talk to mom and dad with open dialogue where we could guide their thought process on this subject. But when I was growing up, sex was voodoo. In fact, I would never say the word out loud, even up and through high school. Like, it was just like, that's just a naughty word. And I grew up thinking sex is nasty, sex is dirty, sex is ugly, save for the one you love. I mean, like, that's kind of how I grew up. It's like, yeah, it's supposed to be a special thing for a marriage, and yet, I don't know, you're not supposed to talk about it, and it's a dirty thing. But I want to tell you this, that sex is God's idea. Sex is a gift from God. It's not something to be embarrassed about. It's just something that we need to have responsibility with. I want to show you an example from what God has shared in creation, in the creation story. God created a perfect relationship, perfect sexuality in a relationship in the Garden of Eden with Adam and Eve. In fact, the Garden of Eden was a paradise, but things went south really quickly. And so I want you, if you will, to turn back in your Bibles to the very beginning, to Genesis chapter 3, and we're going to walk through a passage there as well. If you have one of our Bibles from the information table, it's page 4, right in the beginning. We're going to go through Genesis chapter 1, and we're going to start Genesis chapter 3, rather, starting in verse 1. This chapter is actually dubbed the fall. So God creates the world, then there's Adam and Eve, and then there's the fall in chapter 3. This is what gets written in Genesis chapter 3, verse 1. The serpent was the shrewdest of all the wild animals the Lord God had made. One day he asked the woman, and by the way, I'm going to outline 5 lies that I believe that Satan tries to trick us with along the way. And this is one of them. He says, did God really say? 5 lies. It kind of is like Five Guys, burger and fries, but maybe I don't have burgers on the brain, but 5 lies. First lie Satan fed to Adam and Eve. Did God really say? Did he really tell you that? Is that really true? You must not eat of the fruit from any of the trees in the garden? The response by Eve was this, of course we may eat fruit from the trees in the garden, the woman replied. It's only the fruit from the tree in the middle of the garden that we are not allowed to eat. God said you must not eat it or even touch it. If you do, you will die. Little side note we're not getting into, but God never said don't touch it. That was Eve's little add-on there. Verse 4, here's the second lie. Satan replies, you won't die. God's lying to you. You won't die. Trust me on this one. There's your second lie. The serpent replied to the woman in verse 5. God knows. There's the third lie. He's saying God knows things. He's not telling you. He's not for you. He's holding stuff back from you so he can manipulate the way you respond to him. God knows something. And he goes on to say that your eyes will be open. So the fourth lie is he says, you're actually not only going to be okay doing this, it's going to be better for you if you do because it's going to open up your eyes as soon as you eat it. And then you will be like God. See, he's got you under his thumb right now, but if you eat this fruit, you're going to be like him. It's going to make your life better because you'll know both good and evil. Verse 6, the woman was convinced. She saw that the tree was beautiful and its fruit looked delicious, and she wanted the wisdom it would give her, so she took some of the fruit and ate it. She bought into the lies that Satan gave her. Then she gave some to her husband, and he also bought into the lies. He was with her and he ate it too. Verse 7, at that moment their eyes were opened, and then suddenly they felt shame at their nakedness. See, they were naked already, but now they felt shame. So they sewed fig leaves together to cover themselves. First they felt shame, and this is the fifth lie. We're going to talk about this a little bit later. First there's shame, and then there's hiding. Shame and hiding. Some of you may be in that position right now today where you're feeling shame in your life and you're trying to hide. We're not going to talk about it, but the next few verses, all the way through verse 10, is beautiful because it's actually the story about how they felt shame and God went after them. He chased them. He went into the Garden of Eden and said, Adam and Eve, where are you? Come here, come near me. Let's get together. God pursues them. I want to tell you this morning that God is pursuing you. If you're hiding, know this, he's looking for you. He's saying, where are you? Come to me. Let me help you. God is coming for us. He knows everything we've done, yet he still loves us and he still pursues us. Today's topic isn't going to be very funny, but I thought I'd throw a little joke out there, a little humor in there, kind of lighten the mood a little bit. We're talking about this passage, Genesis 3, and you know, when God goes looking after Adam and Eve, you know, he finds them and they're like, we were hiding from you and all that. So there was this pastor, this is the story goes, there was a pastor, and after church every Sunday, he would go visit all the people, go knock on their doors of all the people that were new to the church that day. Now, I want to let you know, we don't do that. So if you fill out the card, we're not going to come after you like that. Don't get creeped out. But what we will do, we'll probably send you a letter in the mail and saying, hey, thank you for coming today. We are honored that you were here. But this pastor, he'd go visit their houses, and if he knocked on the door and they weren't there, he'd pull out one of his business cards. He thought it was cute to, he'd write a little verse on the back of the card. He'd stick it in the, you know, between the door and the doorpost there. And the verse he wrote was this one, Revelation chapter 3, verse 20, up on the screen here. It said this, he wrote on there, here I am, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in and eat with that person and they with me. And so I thought, oh, that's so cute. He thought that was fun to write that on there, put that in the card. Well, the next Sunday at church, the offering plate passes by, and that card he had written on by the lady who had visited, where the card was back in the offering bucket, but this time it had another verse written next to the one he wrote, and she wrote this verse here, Genesis 3:10. I heard you in the garden and I was afraid because I was naked, so I hid. I don't care what you say, that's funny. Oh, let's have some fun today. So from Genesis chapter 3, I'd like to share with you the five lies that the devil used to trick Adam and Eve. And these lies, they come in steps and they're stages. They go in process. He starts with the first one. And once he's got you with that one, he moves on to the next one. And he builds up these stages till you get to stage 4. And at stage 4, it becomes a very dangerous place to be. He's got you in this point in time. And stage 4, you need to get out of it. Some of you guys today are at stage 4 and you're in a dangerous place. But understand this, we're going to talk today about how you get out of that. So in your notes, five lies. Step 1, the devil always gets us to question God's word. That's the first step. Did he really say? And here's the lie. It looks like something like this in your notes. God's word isn't totally true. There's some stuff that's not quite accurate there. Did God really say that? See, we get caught up in sin that leads to shame, and then that struggle leads us to this lie where we're like, is that really actually bad? Because we don't want to live with our guilt. So we either have to clean up our act, or we have to say, this is justified. And so we start justifying why we're doing what we're doing. It's okay. You know, God's got exceptions. I've heard people say, well, I know it's wrong, but God understands my situation. He loves me, and so he's okay with me doing this. No. You can't buy into that lie. We usually feel this one, by the way, most of the time when God's word is saying something that we don't agree with. Something that we're struggling with. And let me just be very clear with you today. There are parts of this Bible right here that when I read it, I'm like, ooh. That's a tough one. That is really a hard pill to swallow. Have you ever done that? Ever read the Bible? Like, did it really say that in here? Is that for real? And then you get on Google, because Google will tell you anything you want it to, and you go, there's got to be something that contradicts what this says. I mean, there's something there, right? You guys understand that the reason why it's in here is because God's word is meant to convict us. It's meant to compel us to get back on course. And there are difficult things because we all mess up and we all need course correction. I do and you do. No one is exempt. We all need that course correction. So we go through this struggle because we're trying to find ways to be able to hide it. And the question that we have to wrestle with when we look at scripture that maybe we're having a hard time with the scripture is the question is this: do we fit God's word to where we want to be? Or do we go to where God's word is? It reminds me of this cartoon from the 1960s on your screen here, as Brother Juniper, this guy's shooting targets or shooting arrows at the fence, and then he's telling the other guy, he's like, it's easy. First you shoot the arrow, then you just take a paintbrush. Like, we do that with our theology, we do that in our life where we're like, I think I want to go this way. Look, I hit the target. You're always gonna hit the target if you always line up what you believe around what you want to do. But is it the best thing for you? Probably not. There's a phrase that goes around a lot in our culture right now that I want to dispel, and it's just this: you just got to find your own truth. My friends, there's no such thing as your truth and my truth. You can't say, Pastor Mike, you know, I appreciated your message today. I didn't really buy into it. You know, that's your truth. I got a different truth. No, 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 no. You got to understand, there is only one truth. You see, if I were to step off the stage, the one truth is that I would drop because gravity would drop me to the floor. I'm not going to float. We know that. There is no other alternative to that reality, that if I step off the stage, gravity will drop me down. There is only one truth. The question is, how do we find that truth? How do we make sure that what we do in our life lines up with the truth in scriptures? Let me show you what Paul writes in 1 Thessalonians chapter 2 and verse 13. He says this in your notes: and we also thank God continually, because when you received the word of God, underline that word received, when you received the word of God, which you heard from us, you accepted. Underline that word accepted. You received it, you accepted it. It's not a human word, but it actually is the word of God, which is indeed, and underline this last phrase, at work in you who believe. And if you got any space in your notes, you might want to write this down. God's word works, but only when you know it, accept it, and believe it. It only works if you know it, accept it, and believe it. That's why for the last few weeks we've been advertising this thing coming up on Wednesday night starting this week called Foundations. Man, I've got a desire, a passion in my heart for people to understand their faith and why they believe what they believe. It does not go beyond my notice that more than half of you in the room who call yourself a follower of Jesus don't even know what that means. You don't even know what Scripture says. If you did, some of you would be like, well, then I'm not a follower of Jesus. You'd be like, that, what? Are you kidding me? Do we really understand what God's word says, and are we willing to line up with it? Or do we want to choose to become our own God and choose our own path? You have to understand. I want to invite you to come to Foundations. If you haven't signed up, we had a great group of people coming, but we're going to dive in for the next 7 weeks. We're going to dive in to knowing our Bibles better, to understanding them so that we can know what we believe, why we believe it, and how to live it out in our lives. And I invite you to be a part of that. Tim Keller was a pastor, just passed away recently from cancer. He was in New York City. He said this: if your God never disagrees with you, you might just be worshiping an idealized version of yourself. Beware. So that's step one. God's word isn't totally true. Step two, if he gets you to buy into that, then the devil scoffs at the negative consequences of sin, and he'll feed you this lie: that choice won't hurt anything. If you do that, it's not going to bother anybody. This fits into so many categories that we're not going to go into this morning, but it especially fits in the subject we're talking about today. We start believing that if I do this thing that Scripture says is wrong, man, it's not that bad. It's not going to affect anybody. If I watch something inappropriate in private, who's it going to really bother? Who's it going to affect? I can get away with that. It's not really going to bother anybody. We start to buy into this lie that my choice won't hurt anybody or anything. Look what Proverbs 14:12 says: there is a path before each person that seems right, but it ends in death. We pick a path that we think is right, but it will not lead us the way we thought it would go. Then again, I don't feel pressured to convince you of this. I believe life will do this for you. I believe you can find out the easy way or the hard way. But I've learned enough times from going off track of what God has asked me to do with my life, going the wrong path, the wrong way, and fighting against it. It's like a fly. Have you ever seen a fly in the summertime trying to get out of a window, and they just keep smacking up against this invisible thing? It's like I just keep going, I know I can get through if I keep trying it. This is a lot easier than the way God wants me to go. And finally, I wise up, and out I go. But you got to follow God's plan for your life. You got to be willing to do what he says. So we buy into this. We say, well, I can have as many partners as I want. Who's that going to hurt? It's just physical. Sex is just physical. Who does it actually harm? Well, we're two consenting adults. As long as everyone's okay with this, then no one's getting hurt, right? I again want to tell you, God is not against sex. God created. I mean, it's not like God walked into the garden with Adam and Eve one day, and he's like, whoa, he saw him in the bush. He's like, oh my God. I mean, oh, I God. Like, it wasn't like God was looking at that going, oh my goodness, what are they doing? God created it. It is a gift. It is a gift, but only when it's used in the proper context. The one who created it said it works best with certain boundaries. The best way I could illustrate this is to talk about fire. In my house, I have an enclosed gas furnace fireplace. They turn it on, and it's going. And in the wintertime, you know, this last little cold spell we have, you got the fireplace rolling, get a nice hot beverage in your hand. It just warms the soul as you get warm with the fire in the fireplace. But understand this, that fire outside of that fireplace can be very dangerous. It can burn down everything that I've ever owned or cared about in my entire life, including the people I love. Just because it's a wonderful thing does not mean that it's not dangerous. The wonderful thing done the wrong way with the thing we all enjoy creates destruction in our lives. You see, passion needs parameters. In your notes, write that down. It's not on anything, but write that down. Passion needs parameters. One man, one woman in marriage, that is that God's parameters that he set out in Scripture. So here's the third step. First, we buy into the lie that it's God's word isn't totally true. Then we scoff at him and say that choice won't hurt anything. The third thing is the devil tries to accuse God of evil intent. And the lie here is that righteousness is boring. Sin is fun. And by that word righteousness, that's just a fancy way of saying right living. Living the right way is boring. Living in sin is fun. God's for you, rather. He's not against, God's for you. He's not against you. And I want to point out to you the lie, sin is fun. Sin is fun. I mean, honestly, let's just be straight. Sin is fun or no one to do it. It is a lot of fun to do the wrong thing for a season. But understand, just because it's fun does not mean that it does not bring long-term consequences to our life. We have to be careful with it. It's like fire. If we're not careful with it, it will burn us. God's way, by the way, is not boring. When you follow God's plan, it is fun. Now, I'll be honest with you. I've said this before, but if you are a person like me who loves junk food and you've been eating a lot of junk and then you try to eat healthy, let me tell you, healthy food is not fun after eating a whole bunch of junk for a long time. It does not taste good. It does not feel good. There's nothing satisfying about it whatsoever. In fact, you get done with it and you feel empty inside. You're like, where's the good stuff? I'm looking and your mouth is drooling as you look at the commercial on TV for Burger King. And like, you want something better. But here's the thing. If you've been hooked on the right stuff for long enough, you know what starts looking repulsive? The junk. And the problem is we've been on the junk for so long that we look at what is good and we're like, it's so boring. This is the good life. This is fun. But what if we would give up the junk and we would go over and we'd start eating healthy, spiritually speaking, and start taking in the right things and doing the right things. All of a sudden we look at this stuff and we're like, I'm not really craving that anymore. And if you go at it long enough, you start looking at that stuff like, why would I ever want that? I talk to people who eat healthy. That's not me. I talk to people who eat healthy, and they're looking at me. They're like, you got to understand. It'd be better for you. You'd like this. I'm like, no, it's not. I can tell you it's not. But they're right. And if you eat healthy long enough, you start to lose the grip that the junk food has in your life, and eventually you start to be repulsed by it. Imagine what would happen in your life if you lived your life spiritually that way. You got so hooked on the things of God, you started realizing that's where the fun is. That's where the lasting pleasure comes from. And it's the junk food that's been deceiving me all this time. Look in your notes there at Psalm 16:11. He says, you make known to me the path of life. you will underline this phrase, fill me with joy in your presence. And underline this phrase, with eternal pleasures at your right hand. Do we find fulfillment and true lasting joy doing the things of God, lining up with his will? When you follow God's plan, you will experience intimacy and pleasure at a level that no human being can create. No drug can recreate it. Nothing else you can do. When you follow God's plan, that is ecstasy. When you follow God's plan, and by the way, I don't have the articles before, but I've read articles from Time Magazine where they polled people who were faithful partners in a monogamous relationship as a married couple compared to people who were not, the people who looked like they were having a lot of fun, and there was always a constant higher level of satisfaction in the married couples who were faithful to each other than in the other relationships. It even plays out in real life. It's not just the Bible teaching us. It actually is trying to protect us from things that could lead us down the wrong path. Some people think, well, if I were God, I would accept everybody in there, you know, whatever they do. I'm not going to judge anybody. God's just, he's mean. He doesn't love. He isn't judging. And as if though somehow you would be more loving than God because you would be accepting of everything that everybody else does. How many of you guys in here are parents? What would happen if you went home for a whole week and you just decided, kind of like that movie Yesterday, you went home and decided that everything your kids said they wanted to do and everything they wanted to be involved with, you're like, I love you. You go do it because I'm not going to resist you. I love you. Any parent think that's a great strategy for parenting your kids? Here's the most loving thing that God does. He calls us out on our sin. Most loving thing we do as parents isn't butting up to our kids and making them feel like we're the coolest person around. It's those hard conversations where we have to sit them down and say, there's going to be consequences for your action because if we don't fix this, this is going to cause you major issues later down the road. Most loving thing that God does for us is he corrects us when we sin. Here's the fourth step, and this is where it starts getting dangerous. The devil advertises sin as beneficial. Here's the lie. Your life will be better with you leading it. Now you're starting to move into that role of playing God in your life. You will be better off with you leading it. You're, not only is sin okay, but it's better than God's plan. You'll start thinking that you know what's best for your life. We get into this place all the time, and I'm a huge proponent of us changing this mindset. We get into this space of thinking that somehow our feelings are right and accurate, and our feelings will lead us to the right place. Have you ever heard that phrase, follow your heart? Do you know that the phrase that we use in our culture, well, the heart wants what the heart wants, was actually quoted for the very first time by Woody Allen after he was asked about his relationship with his daughter? Is that the direction you want to go, follow your heart? You see, our feelings are great followers. They are horrible leaders. They will lead you down the wrong path. Can you imagine when I got married to my wife? Like, I remember standing at the altar and this beautiful foxy lady's walking down the aisles. And I'm like, hubba bubba. I get to be with her later tonight. This is awesome. I'm like, this is exciting. And that's my emotion speaking. That's great. Let's get together. And then 3 days later, I'm like, who are you, woman? What planet are you from? Like, what are you doing? What is that? I didn't know that. You should have disclosed that before we got married. That's the weirdest thing I've ever seen someone do. You start following your emotions, your feelings. You know what your emotions and feelings are going to tell you? It's time to get out. It's time for a divorce. Do not follow your emotions. Do not follow your feelings. I said, till death do us part, and I meant it. Thank goodness I don't follow my feelings. I follow God's truth in my life. You've got to do that. That's why I want to live as much as possible a surrendered life to God, that my life, my choices, they're not my own. They're God's. I've surrendered my life, my body, everything that I am to God to follow him, not my feelings. In your notes, 1 Corinthians 6, Paul writes this, don't you realize that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit who lives in you and was given to you by God? You do not belong to yourself, for God bought you with a high price, so you must honor God with your body. Wow. You see, when we become a follower of Jesus, we surrender the rights to make the call in our life. We surrender it to God. Say, God, you know best. I'm going to follow your plan. You surrender my body, surrender my choices to him. I remember one time years ago, I was on vacation with my family, and I ended up going to the hot tub at our hotel. And there was a group of young college, I was probably just out of high school, young college age kids, boys and girls that were in the hot tub. And there was smoking of pot and a lot of drinking. And I was hanging out there with the hot tub, and we started talking, and they were from Utah. And all of them had been like forced and pressured to follow the Mormon way as they were growing up. And they were like, they admittedly say, we were sick of it. We were rebelling. We're just going out there. And they were talking to me, and they asked me if I wanted a cigarette or if I wanted, they were just trying to be nice, want a beer or whatever. And I said, I'm sorry, I don't smoke. I've never drunk in my life. And I remember this one girl that she was there. She was about 22, 23 years old. And she looks at me, she goes, you've never drank in your entire life? And I'm like feeling like, yeah, I'm kind of weird. I know. And she's like, that is so cool. And she looked at my life and she says, I wish I had that in my life. And all the things that I abstained from, there's things that I can attribute to my parents and then also just me following their advice. But the music I listened to was not sexual and leading my mind down the wrong path. The movies that I watched, did you know, I have not watched rated R movies since college. It was a covenant I signed at my Bible college, and I've decided to stick with it the rest of my life. I can't imagine that I'm missing something that I needed essential in my life, watching rated R movies, but it's kept my mind pure. There are certain things I won't see. Certain things that I won't expose myself to. And people, when I was growing up, were like, oh my goodness, I'm so sorry. You've been so, you know, suppressed and repressed your whole life. No, it's the best thing that ever happened to me. You see, it was an investment in my future. If you know finances, you know that the way that you become successful financially is you have to make hard, disciplined choices now with the way you spend and use your money now that are difficult. As everybody's out there going and spending what they got, and you're like, no, I'm going to save. Because one day, it's an investment, one day it's going to pay back in dividends. Same is true in your faith. Giving up something now for something better isn't a sacrifice, it's an investment. And I'm going to now walk you into this last and final step. This is the dangerous one. The devil uses the sin now because he's got you. Those four, you fell for the lie like Eve did. She took the fruit, she's like, this is good, I want the wisdom it's going to give me. She takes a bite, she's fallen for it. And you may have fallen for some lie, some version of a lie in your life that has led you down the wrong path, and you've fallen into sin. I know I've done it more times than I care to admit. Here's the lie that Satan feeds you at this point in time. It's too late to fix what I've messed up. The final lie is the slam dunk. He's got you. It's interesting to me. His strategy is, come on, come on, come on. And once you've done it, he's like, oh my goodness, you did that? Oh, you're done. You should have never done that. He pulls you in, and then he shames you for what you've done. And I believe when it comes to sexuality, we've stigmatized certain sins as worse than others, when in all reality, unfaithfulness to God is unfaithfulness. Paul says in Romans 3:23, all have sinned and fallen short of God's glory. No one's an exception. Not me, not you, not anyone else. Sin is sin. Psalm 34:5 says, this is the verse to remember this week. Those who look to him for help, underline that phrase, look to him for help, will be radiant with joy. Listen to this, no shadow of shame. No shadow of shame will darken their faces. Here's the thing I want you to understand. In the church, we got to stop judging people because their sin seems like it stinks more than yours. That is not okay. We all sin. We all fall short. There's a phrase when you walk out the door on the window that's placed on some boards on a sign that says, no perfect people allowed, and we mean it. No perfect people allowed here. We all mess up. So if you're in a place where you're feeling shame in this area or another area, understand this, you're not going to get judgment here. Now understand there's a difference between acceptance and approval. Here's the thing. If you want to, the world will accept everything you do, and they are welcoming you with open arms. Oh, it's okay that you want to be that way. It's okay that you want to do these things. What we need as a church need to be the safest place for people to feel accepted and not approved of what their behavior is, but accepted for who they are and go through this journey together of getting our lives on track for God. There's three responses you can have today from today's message. I want to walk you through these as we wrap up our time together. First, you might hear this, and I've heard this before. Won't surprise me that it might be some of you in the room that are in this place now. It's defensiveness. Oh, Pastor Mike, that was great. Usually, you know, you're right on, but this one here, it's kind of not the direction that I'm heading. I don't know if I buy into it. Your truth, that's good for you, but it's not good for me. Nah, I don't subscribe to this. I'm not going to accept this. And there's excuses. There's a defense. Again, you don't need my permission to do what you want to do or believe what you want to believe. That is your choice. I'll never judge you. But understand this, if you go down that path, I promise you, because I've seen it time and time again, you will be back. And I want you to know the lights will always be on. We will always be here ready and accepting you. You can come as long as you want saying you don't agree with what we're doing. That's fine. You believe what you want to believe. But I promise you, you stay at this long enough and you will find that God's way is always the best way in your life. Instead of saying, my will be done, what we need to do is say, thy will be done. That's what Jesus said in the garden, Luke chapter 22, verse 42. He said, not my will, God, but yours. That was his response when God called him to give his life up for us. He said, I don't want to do it, but whatever you want, I'm going to follow through with that. So one response would be defensiveness. Another one is shame. You hear today going, I get it, Pastor Mike. I line up with what you're saying. I agree with you. But I think my life is too far gone. You have no clue how deep I've dove into this area. God can't even work with someone like me. I can't tell you many times. I don't know where this comes from. I think it's the world. Where this comes from where we say, I'm too far gone for God. When everything in Scripture says God's grace is sufficient and nothing can separate us from his love. There's nothing that you can ever do in this area or any other that'll ever make God love you any less than he does right now. God loves you more than you can imagine. You don't have to live in that shame. Romans 8:1, Paul writes this, therefore, there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. No condemnation. Goes on to say this in verse 2, because through Christ Jesus, the law of the Spirit who gives life has set you free from the law of sin and death. That is what God offers each one of us. So don't ever think that I've gone too far and feel that shame. Shame, by the way, is a trick that the devil uses. God uses conviction. He says, oh, there's a better way. You see what you did? If you went this way, it'd be better. He's not judging. He's just trying to redirect you. Satan looks at it and says, no way. God can't use that. Never, no how. Do you want to know this? The people that God uses the most in life are the biggest screw-ups. Because if we weren't, you know what we do? We'd be tempted to believe it was because of our own power that we were able to get by with it. It is the people who are screwed up the most. You read scripture and you read story after story of people who messed their lives up and God chose with his grace to go above that and say, I'm going to use you for great things. The author Paul, who we've quoted several times this morning, Paul was one of the biggest screw-ups. He stood at the feet, or the people put the coats at their feet that were stoning Stephen, who was a Christian, who was testifying for God, and they didn't like it, and he was cheering them on, and he went to different cities with letters to be able to throw Christians in prison for what they were preaching, that Jesus is real, that he's alive, and he can save them. He says it in his scripture, I'm the chief of sinners. God uses screw-ups. That's the only people he uses. So don't ever buy into the lie that you're too screwed up for God to use. Here's the third and final, and I believe the best approach to today's message, and that's repentance. Not repentance like the guy in the bullhorn at the Rose Garden when you go to a game and they're yelling and screaming, you maggot, you filthy maggot, repent. You know what repentance means? To change your mind. I'm going this way, this is the wrong way. Ooh, I repent. Repent. If I go this way and I decide this is the wrong way, repentance is me turning around saying, no, I'm going to go this way. That's all it means. To repent, to turn from the direction you were headed and go a different way. In your notes, 2 Corinthians 7:10, godly sorrow brings repentance that leads to salvation and leaves no regret. But worldly sorrow brings death. You don't want Satan's version of sorrow. You want God's version that says, it's not the way I want to go with my life. I'm not really proud of what I've done in my past, but thanks be to God for his grace that covers over my mistakes. I'm going to turn and choose to go the right way now. You might want to write this on your notes. It's not in there. Repentance is a moment of pain. I'm not going to lie to you. The times that I've had to repent in my life, it is painful. It is not fun to admit that I've been wrong, to say, God, I'm sorry, I messed up. Will you forgive me? Repentance is not fun. It is a moment of pain. But understand this, being unrepentant is a lifetime of pain. Which do you want? God loves you. He's looking to you saying, where are you? I'm here. I want to help you. We can get through this together. Do you want that kind of repentance in your life? That kind of restored relationship with your God in heaven? This could be your year. Would you bow your heads with me? Now, normally I'd invite those of you who want to make a decision for Jesus, but this morning I want to invite everybody in this room to make a fresh commitment when it comes to sexual purity. It's one of our next steps today. And if you're struggling in any area, or even if you're on the right track, it's a recommitment that you're going to stay on track. But I just would like to say a prayer for each one of us today. And as I say this prayer out loud, you can repeat these words in your own heart as a way of saying, God, I'm committing to your plan, your boundaries, your guidance for this area of my life. Dear God, we know what your word teaches. Help me today to have strength to overcome the areas of weakness in this area in my life. God, teach me the truth. Show me the lie for what it really is. Help me to get my life back on track and to follow your prescription for healthy sexual relationships. God, I commit to this today. And if you're with your heads bowed still and your eyes closed, I do want to address those who might be in the room today and you've never actually made a decision to follow Jesus, to surrender your life to him. And I don't want to go by today without giving you the opportunity to do that. I promise you, there's many things in God's word that does not make sense, but if you follow it, it'll start becoming clear to you later. And if you make that decision today to follow Jesus, to surrender your life to him, it's not just believing in him, but surrendering your life to him, as best as you know how, for the rest of your life, it'll change you bigger and better than any change you've ever made in your life. And if that's you, as I say this prayer out loud, I invite you to say it silently in your own heart and say these words, Jesus, thank you for taking away my sin. Today I receive you as my Savior and my Lord. Today I'm giving you control of my life. I'm going to follow your way completely, entirely, as best as I can. Save me, change me, and give me the power through your Holy Spirit to live the life you always intended for me to live. And if this is you today, profess this to God today. God, I believe you are the Son of God. I believe that you died and you rose again. And today I put my faith in you. It is in your name I pray. Amen. Guys, thank you for listening to me today, and I hope that today challenges you. I think it challenges me, by the way, so you know that when I'm preparing a message, there are things that I'm looking at and going, I need to work on that. And I hope every time you come, there's something that you could take away that you go, you know what, that's something that I can apply to my life. This can strengthen me in this area, and I hope that you're doing that today. And if you just made that decision and you prayed that prayer with me to accept Jesus into your life, congratulations. What an amazing choice you made. I can't promise you rainbows and unicorns, but I can promise you this. You keep your life on track for God and watch over time how consistently your life gets better and better. And we want to help you on that journey. And so if you'll, on your orange card that Devin was talking about earlier, if you take that on the backside and check that first next step that you made a decision today to follow Jesus, we won't harass you, but we will. And by the way, you have to print your information legibly if you want it to get to you, but we won't harass you. We're just going to send you a simple email with some resources to help you guide the process, basically, of you knowing what's the next best step for me in my new faith with Jesus. And we just want to partner with you on that process. So I encourage you to check that box as well as any of the other next steps that apply to you. Make sure you're always looking for opportunities to take action, because what you hear does nothing for you if it doesn't change what you do. All right, in a moment, the team is going to come forward with some buckets, and so I want to warn you that we're going to be receiving the offering here momentarily. If you want to give, there's an envelope in your program. You can give it here live physically, or if you want to, there's options online. You can check one of those out and give that way if that's your preferred method, but I do want to just make sure you're prepared for that, as well as your connection card. Now is the time to finish filling them out. Make sure you spelled everything correctly, and if you've got some next steps or some sign me up for us, make sure you get those checked on so we can get you the appropriate information on those. But I'm going to have the team come forward in a moment, and then you'll be able to pass those also, and that'll be your cue when the bucket comes by your row. One thing I want to tell you about, if you're on this journey of faith, we're always looking for ways to help you take the next step in your faith journey. And if you just made a decision to follow Jesus, or you've done that at any point in time in your life, but you've never taken this next step of baptism, could I encourage you to consider doing that? We're going to be baptizing at the end of the month. This is a special day. When we baptize, it is a celebration. It's one of the most special things for us as a church to be a part of when someone is getting baptized. It's like going to a wedding and being able to witness that special moment. Baptism is one of those special landmark moments in someone's life where they say, I've made a decision previously to follow Jesus, and I want everyone to know that I'm a follower of him. I'm proud of this. And so you're just in front of everybody professing this decision you made. In fact, we talk about baptism as the wedding ring of the Christian life. I share this with kids when I'm teaching them about baptism. Like, when I take my ring off, does that mean I'm no longer married? And they're like, no, you're still married. I'm like, how do you know? The ring's gone. Well, your ring isn't what made you married, is it? I'm like, no, you're right. That's it. I'm still married with the ring off, but when I put it on, it tells everybody I'm taken. That's what baptism is. It does not make you a believer, but what it does is it shows everybody else I'm taken. I'm his, and I'm proud of it. And so I invite you, if you want to, check that box, and we'll get you all the appropriate information so you can sign up to be a part of that baptism. All right, go ahead, team, and come forward. As they're coming forward, I just want to bow and pray with you as you prepare to receive the offering. God, this morning, we just want to say thank you for all you're doing in our life, for all the blessings. I know sometimes life is difficult and stressful and hard, but if we stop long enough and pause, we see moments in our reflection of your grace, of your goodness in our life. So today, God, as we reflect on that, as we give our offerings, let them be out of response of generosity and a heart of worship to say, God, thank you. Thank you for how you're working in my life. Thank you that you've saved me. Thank you that you're using me and you're growing me into the person you want me to be. So I give my offering today to you, God, as my act of worship. Thank you for this. In your name we pray. Amen. All right, watch for that bucket pass by your row, and you can drop your offerings and cards in while they do. And while they're passing the buckets by, I want to share with you guys kind of a little report. If you remember back in December, we did a Christmas offering, and one of our groups that we were working with that's local here in the Portland area is Refugee Care Collective. This is a group of people that work with different community organizations and a lot of churches to offer support and help people who are fleeing from their home nation because of war and violence. Like, literally, they're getting out to save their life. They come and they get landed in Portland and placed in this area. And in the Portland metro area, they expect more than 1,000 refugees from mostly, I believe it's the Republic of Congo, Afghanistan, and Ukraine to be replaced in the Portland metro area this year. And so this organization comes alongside with them. They partner with them to share with them language and customs, to give them the right tools. A lot of these people flee with a suitcase or maybe even just the clothes on their back. And so they set them up with all these opportunities to succeed in basically starting over their life as a family. And so we are partnered with them as a result of the Christmas offering. We're going to be supporting them monthly for the entire year of 2024. They reached out to us this last week and they said, we have an opportunity. We want to see if you could be a part of it. And I said yes before asking you guys. So I apologize in advance. They're putting together what they call restart kits, these big kits, really helpful kits with just basic home necessities and supplies. And they're looking to partner with 40 churches in the Portland area. Each church is responsible for a different item. The one that we selected is a kit that includes shampoo, conditioner, toothbrush, toothpaste, those four items. Now, if you want to be a part of this, we're going to start collection next week, but don't do this. Don't go buy 40 toothbrushes. They're kits. So if you buy 40 toothbrushes, you better have 40 shampoos, conditioners, and toothpaste. They come as packages. It's not fair to everybody else if you took all of one item and then someone else brings it. So we're looking for a minimum of 50, but all the way up to 250 if we can supply them. And so if you can collect, and by the way, we're looking for new, specifically that toothbrush, better be new. We're looking for new items, shampoo, conditioner, toothbrush, toothpaste. And if you want to bring sets of four of or those four things in a set, you can bring as many sets as you want. We'll start collecting them next week all the way through to the end of the month. So it gives you a little time to think about that and look for the sales or whatever you want to do to get those supplies. But we'd love to have you be a part of that as we continue to support the Refugee Care Collective and show the love of Jesus to these people who are moving into a place that's completely unfamiliar to them and they're really scared to death about what's going on in their life and how to restart. So wanted to offer you guys that opportunity. Next week, we come back with part two. It'll be a lot lighter next week as we talk about relationships in a different aspect. Each week, we're going to talk about different aspects of relationships. They're all going to be applied to every one of us. So we're going to talk about marriage. We're going to talk about the single life. We're going to talk about toxic relationships. We're going to talk about your work relationships. So you don't want to miss out. Here's the deal. There are people that you know who are not here with you today who need to hear what we're going to share next week. Do not miss the opportunity this week to invite them to come back with you. If you don't have an invite card, go to the information table where the Bibles are and grab a Bible, by the way, if you don't have one of those, and grab those invite cards. You can grab as many as you want, put them in your wallet or purse, and use them as a tool to invite people to come back with you next Sunday. All right, why don't you stand up as you're leaving today? Make sure you say hi to a few folks you sat next to. I'll be out on the patio. I'd love to see you as you leave today. Have a great week, and we'll see you back here next Sunday.